Okay, so this is Mark Sargent, and this is part two of Flat Earth Q&A emails. Again, if you want to see the video version, me mugging in front of the camera, you can go to marksargent.com and you'll see the video version of this. If you're on YouTube, you're just going to get the slideshow version of this, but basically it's me reading a bunch of emails that get sent to me because I get so many emails that I can't even possibly cram them all into all the Strange World episodes that I've done, especially since I've been taking a lot more phone calls on Strange World. So with that, let's just get right to it and see how many we can rip through in the next hour. This one, the subject line is Flat Earth from Chris in Maryland. Hello, my name is Chris, and I am a huge supporter. Let me move this over here. Of your videos, I'm actually watching your latest one right now, and I'm a believer in Christ, and I realized a globe I had as a child had a logo right next to Australia. Interesting, I wonder what could have been hidden, and why can't anyone go to Antarctica? I think it's the edge of the earth where the firmament meets the ground. Also, I have found zero evidence of a ball. Earth, all my friends think I'm crazy, but my mom thinks I smoke too much weed. Nice. But keep up the videos. I have watched countless hours on this topic, and the proof multiplies. The moon landing was filmed in a studio. That's why there are roads on the way to Disneyland. Walt Disney was a Freemason named NASA. Oh, Rhodes named NASA. Nice. Strange. I hope you read this out loud in one of your videos. Good luck to your research. I will be watching Chris. Thanks, Chris. That's awesome. Steve writes, subject is AE Map. Hi, Mark. Thank you for your work. It blew my mind. I've started some of my own research on the Flat Earth and would really appreciate a link to or a copy of an AE Map if you have it. I'm quite interested in the satellite issue. As a commercial skipper and marine radio operator, I have a few theories that I would love to put to the test, but require a large copy of the AE map to accurately plot with. Any assistance would be greatly appreciated. Best regards, Steven Peterson, George, Western Cape, South Africa. Steve, it's easy to find an AE map. Really, the best one, the one that I choose anyway, is the one that's on Wikipedia. It's the azimuthal, A-Z-I-M-U-T-H-A-L, equidistant map, which is just a projection, and it's pretty high res. It's not bad at all. I mean, yeah, there's one of the AE maps that's out there. It's an older one, but it's super high res, but it's a drawing. It's not necessarily computer generated. So they're not hard to find. Just type in azimuthal equidistant projection. You'll find it. Carlos writes, Flat Earth under the dome. Sir, thank you for the video. I thought the same thing about Antarctica, a landmass that no corporation exploited. Yeah, right. And so my curiosity started. Again, thank you for the information. Very respectfully, Carlos. Yep. Absolutely right. Antarctica, if anyone is new to this and watching Flat Earth, and this is your first Flat Earth video, I don't know why it would be. Antarctica, 1959 treaty, Antarctic treaty, which says no corporation from any country anywhere in the world is allowed to do work down in Antarctica. Millions and millions of square miles, if you believe the continent explanation by science. And no one's there. The treaty isn't even up for review until the year 2041, and it's been in place since 1951. 100-year treaty that's never been broken by anyone. Please, human beings, that's what we live to do, is break treaties. Ask the Native Americans, or the Native anybody, for that matter. Let's see. Subject line, no forests on Flat Earth video. Hi, Mark. Intro praise. Me and my wife enjoy the recordings of your radio show every week. Great fun and info, too. And intro praise. Background info. Wow, very official, this guy. I'm a flat earther since January of this year. After Dave's interview on the Macedonian late night show, he's talking about Dave Murphy on the Macedonian late night show. Please, everyone, catch that. If it's on my channel, I mirrored it, and it's also on his channel. And I'm digging into this since then. And info. A note about the video. This video, it's completely mind blowing. The summer mind scramble, as someone said, and makes sense, and it flows the river to your mill, as the saying goes. I have never heard that about the subcontractors that made our earth, but from a Christian perspective, it might as well be the civilization that tried to make the Babylon Tower before the mixing of the tongues. Just a thought. Stay flat, Alexander. And he spells it A-L-E-K-S-A-N-D-A-R. Steve writes, "Hey, yes, Sarge." I get that nickname every once in a while. "Just joined your website. First video playing now I went to was the medical cannabis video." And I'm sorry you guys are hearing a truck in the background. "I was really concerned about how you would approach it. But I am hugely satisfied with your point of view. I agree 100% and am a daily user. For me, there is nothing like it. It's peace. Staring at the night sky, I feel so connected to everything in some way that is not describable by language. Thanks for the video and your openness on this planet, which was put here for us plant by the creator. Yes, that is my opinion, Steve." Awesome. Lynn writes a question. "Hi, Mark. It seems just like everyone else, I have gone through the emotions, LOL. That first, what a crock till now, when I have researched as much as possible and been laughed at by my daughter, surprisingly not my 14-year-old granddaughter. My question is, am I feeling completely alone with this? What would you suggest would be a good site to join to talk with other like-minded flat earthers?" The answer to that real quick would be flatearthfriends.com, I believe, run by GeoShifter. Try that if you get a chance. But also, you know, there's join any one of the roundtables that gets picked up. There's live discussions all the time, or just listen in and see what you kind of feel like. But go to Flat Earth Friends. That's a pretty good one. Also, go to MarkSargent.com. There's people there who are joining up as kind of like Flat Earth Friends. Watched a very calm and informative video. Obviously, a lot is repeated, but some new nuggets come out the other night with a chap named Dave Murphy. Go figure. I just talked about him in the last email. I feel a lot better when I hear people like yourself and him talk about this subject. I've only chatted with one other person on the subject, and it went over reasonably well, but then I wondered if she thought I was on one of my conspiracy theories. It's very daunting to think we are so few. Thanks very much, Linda." And no, Linda, you were not so few. There's a lot of conspiracy people out there, closet conspiracy people. And that's what really the whole Flat Earth Awakening has done. It's created a whole new level of open-minded people that are just now getting into conspiracy for the first time. It's like Flat Earth opens up a series of locks, and behind those doors are all the other conspiracies. Really, once you accept Flat Earth, every conspiracy comes back on the table. With the exception of, I think there was only one, and I'm not kidding when I say this, that Elvis is still alive. I don't believe Elvis is still alive. But everything else, I think, is way back on the table. Now, of course, yeah, I disagree with Richard Hoagland's, there are people living on the moon and people living on Mars and all the other planets, because there are no planets. Not that I don't hate the theory, but it completely doesn't fit with the model of Flat Earth, so I don't think it's crazy. Whereas Elvis being alive, that's a completely different story. So, thanks, Linda. This one is called Wow. Mark, when my 28-year-old daughter first had me watch your videos, I thought it was a joke or a reverse title. You know, the kind of video that says something ludicrous and then proceeds to show you that you are correct to believe what you believe. Then, when I realized that you were serious, I thought you had to be an idiot. But I continued watching. After 6 hours of videos in the Flat Earth, my head was spinning. It was even a bit frightening, this new concept, challenging what I thought was the truth. I grew up on Star Trek, saw Star Wars when it came out for my 16th birthday. I've always wanted to write sci-fi and even illustrate a story for heavy metal, but I have become a Flat Earth believer. I now believe that it is flat and have even tried to convince a few other people. Mostly, they look at me as if I've lost my mind. Capital LOL. Here's a couple of pieces I have done since becoming a convert." Now that's awesome. And now I've got to increase the font size, so give me 1 second. All right, we're back. This email is from Eric. He says, "Questions for your show. Hey Mark, thanks for informative and interesting programs. Would appreciate if you can answer the following questions on your next show or shows. One, you often claim that because mankind is naturally destructive and dangerous, we need to be kept enclosed and away from what's outside the enclosure. But wars are not started by common people, but by those in charge, and most of them are manufactured and based on fear-based lies meant to benefit warmongering bankers and power brokers who enjoy seeing death and destruction, who already know about the enclosure either way. Is it the fallen who you really mean need to be kept imprisoned? Because I prefer to judge mankind as basically good in nature and desiring peace and harmony in society as long as basic needs are provided and society has certain safeguards and structure. Yes and no. Yes, do I think the fallen are probably here lying around me? Who knows, maybe underground, maybe, are they the first renters of this apartment or first occupants of this apartment? Yeah, probably. Do I think the fallen are responsible for everything bad that has happened with humanity? No, I think humanity still has some real problems left on their own. It's possible, that's the big qualifier here, left on their own. When human beings have no common goal, no common cause, they tend to turn on each other really quickly and in horrible ways. And that's what I think the Ronald Reagan speech was about at the UN, oof, years and years ago, back in the late 80s, I'm not mistaken, where he was saying that, wouldn't all our problems go away? Wouldn't we stop quibbling amongst ourselves if there was an external threat or even external guidance? So, yes and no. I mean, yeah, the fallen have something to do with this, but humanity has a real flaw, and that is we don't. We get restless real easily. Kind of like the flat earth movement in some ways. The flat earth movement, sorry, slash awakening, it's kind of a microcosm of what is happening in the world, whereas we don't have an opponent. The flat earth doesn't have anyone to fight against because no science, no academic person, no astrophysicist, no astronomer, no anybody that ends in an ology is willing to go up against this thing because they're afraid of losing. They don't want to put themselves out there, and because of that, we're sitting in our base camp, just tense, pent up, trying to, it's like, who do we fight? Well, let's fight each other until then. And once we do get an opponent that steps forward, all that'll go away, which is why I'm not really worried about the dissension in the ranks right now. So anyway, let's get back to a second question. Second question is, you often describe the creators of the enclosure as purposely wanting to fool us into thinking we are living on a planet like a giant planetarium. Yet at the same time, you admit that up until 500 years ago, it was commonly known that we lived on a flat enclosed plane, as stated in the Bible and other ancient texts. Then 500 years ago, the whole modern universe theory with planets, stars, etc., was promoted and pushed, which eventually replaced the flat earth theories and acceptance. I have trouble reconciling your assumption that the planet and stars theory is what the creators intended us to experience, since it is only a theoretical concept based on a false science. If no one knew about this theory, they of course would judge their surroundings exactly on what they experience, a stationary flat plane with twinkling lights above us, and a daylight and night light rotating above us, made by an intelligent creator for us, as truthfully stated in ancient texts. But I also believe that whoever built this place really wanted us to feel like it was a globe. You've got to get rid of the fence sooner or later, and technologically, what better way to do that than to make the fence non-existent? Make it to where there is no fence. Tell everybody there's no fence, and here's why. Because it's a globe. You can go around it all day long, and you're never ever going to find the fence. And people bought it. And all you have to do is seal off the outer edge and the upper edge, and gently push people away, and that's it. That's all you need. And it worked. So, yes, I absolutely think that the creators. Oh, sirens, my ride's here. No, I'm totally kidding. That's just a siren going by on the road. I do think whoever built this place wanted us to think that there were planets, and I think that that idea was artificially inserted into some people's heads 500 years ago, and then it became a scientific doctrine. And for the last 500 years, we've been building off that foundation. Why not? How else are you going to do it? If you don't, all right, let me go out a different way. Since this person's asking this, how would you get rid of the fence? You've got to change the shape of the world eventually. And that is, if you don't, the people are going to find the fence. And if they find the fence, and I say the fence, it could be the wall, the barrier, whatever you call it. The fence is an easy term to understand. If they find the fence, that's all they're going to think about. That's all they're going to deal with. So if you get a better way of doing it other than creating a globe model, a solar system model, where it's a ball spinning through space and you can't get off of it, I'd like to hear it. Please. Up until now, nobody's come up with anything. Three, this question becomes more interesting after there is no trees on flat earth vid. It says in the Bible that one day for God is 1,000 years for man. Maybe, maybe not. This reminds me of how small insects live a few days, but we can live up to 100 years. Considering the size of this place in relation to our tiny physical bodies, could God or the creators actually be gigantic physical beings, literally thousands of our miles in height, who literally live thousands of our years? Because if they are not, what kind of technology do you use? And the creators, as physical beings, are proportionally similar in size to us and make such a giant place with a dome. Or is it simply supernatural magic we cannot fathom? No, whoever created this place probably lived extremely long lifespans. I mean, you've got to if you're going to create a project like this, because Rome wasn't built a day, and this place certainly wasn't built in a year or 100 years. It took a long time to build this place. And so time for them is probably, their perception of time is probably much different. It's probably relative. So when they're looking at us going through centuries, maybe it's not that long to them. Very possible. Fourth question. Are the creators good, evil, or neutral? Are those in charge, the New World Order, etc., in cahoots with the God, with God and the creators, or in opposition? Oof, a lot of questions. I believe the creators are neutral for the most part. I don't think they're really either good or evil. They are, they just want to see how this world pans out, and they want us to be, they want us to develop and evolve, not in the evolution type of way, but grow and learn. I think they're rooting for us, to be honest. If they didn't, why not just torture us on a regular basis? I know people say, well, this world's horrible anyway, but it's like, yeah, there's a lot of people that are having an okay time. So I think they're, but I think they're mostly neutral. When you're that old and that wise and that powerful, I don't think, and of course I think there's a balance. I think there's, because good and evil isn't so much a concept to me as much as positive and negative, or constructive and destructive. Good and evil seems too easy a term. Do I think the NWO is cahoots with them? No. Do I think they have more information about them? Yes. Do I think they may even use the excuse that God or the creators threatened them at some point, which will leave them off the let them off the hook? I've stated several times that the only reason I think that NASA would get off the hook is because they would come back and say, well, the aliens made us do it, or we were forced, we were doing it for you, doing it to save your lives, in which case we'd buy it. Of course we would. So are they in cahoots? Yeah, I don't think so. I think that we were supposed to naturally find this place. I think we're naturally supposed to discover our surroundings years ago. And that has been artificially extended because the powers that be don't want to give up the powers that they have. And that's where I think we are. Let's see. You mentioned that every civilization meets its end, and that there have been cycles of civilization, that we are not the first residents of this apartment. Yes, he's been paying attention. And you have mentioned that when a cycle of mankind realizes that they are an enclosure, they are then destroyed by those in charge. I didn't say destroyed. I said that there would be a huge change. Now, how many people survive the big change? Hard to say. And does the world completely change? And yeah, all the remnants of those civilization, most of the remnants, are they wiped out? And yes, we don't know how long it takes. We don't know exactly the procedure involved, although we do have rumors of a great flood from years ago. Anyway, what kind of good God would wipe out billions of innocent lives, and why, when it is the evil leaders of this world who should be the ones destroyed? Are they evil leaders, or are they evil NPCs? And by NPCs, I mean non-player characters. How many people are actually living on this world with us? Is the person that's listening to this right now, are they one of just a handful of people that are actually really here? Compared to, if you're wiping out billions of people, that's one thing. If you're wiping out billions of just numbers in a program, that's a completely different thing. So I don't think. that a god would wipe out billions of and by the way, when you say innocent lives, how many people are actually innocent? You know, and again, it comes down to who you think's alive, who you think isn't alive, and how many good people are there. Remember, this is a learning process. We are not here to necessarily have a good time. I again, it's got to steal from the Matrix line where Agent Smith says that, you know, human beings define the reality through misery and suffering, which is why the Matrix was redesigned to this, you know, the peak of your human civilization. It doesn't feel like if the world can only be one of three things, one being education, two being entertainment, the third being confinement. It feels out of all three of those to be really education, because if it's entertainment, why isn't everybody having a good time? If it's confinement, then why isn't more obviously a jail? And the only thing, you know, school kind of feels like all three of those things. You know, when if you remember going to school, yeah, you're there and you're sort of confined. I mean, you could leave and play hooky if you wanted to. Yeah, you have a good time every once in a while at school, but most of the time it's a learning process. And that's where I think we are. And let's see here. Are we simply helpless insects in an ant farm lab test at the whims of a cold, heartless creator, or are we special, unique, loved, and cared for? I think the latter. I think we are special, unique, loved, and cared for. And I think, honestly, if you want to take even the bigger picture, is that we are here deliberately. We are part of, I will use the Bill Hicks line, and that is we're part of a ride, which is, you know, there's thrills and spills and chills. You know, and you think you're in dire straits most of the time, but you're on a ride. The only difference is we don't know we're on a ride. It's one thing when you go on a roller coaster. Everybody knows when they go on a roller coaster, it's scary, and every turn, it's like you know, it's kind of iffy. But in the back of your mind, it's like, well, I know I'm on a ride, and thousands of people have been on this ride. Nobody's died on this ride. Well, imagine if you woke up on that ride. And you had no idea how you got there, and you had no concept of what a ride was. Then every turn would be life and death, and you would have all these precarious moments. And then, like Bill Hicks says, somebody tells you that it's a ride, and it kind of ruins the whole thing. But eventually, we were going to find this out, that we were on a ride. We're here as a perspective. We are here to learn. We are here to give us a different take on where we were. Remember, there cannot be any light without shadow, heat without cold, for lack of a better term, good without bad. And because of that, you have to have a world like this. If you believe in heaven, nirvana, Shambhala, wherever you want to call it, the unlimited universe that lies beyond this place, how can you appreciate that unless you come to a place like this? Super conflicted, super concentrated. Everything is short term. Everything, you know, your experiences are way more intense. This gives you the ability to appreciate an unlimited universe. I firmly believe that. I'm always going to believe that. I'm not exactly going to tell you why. Let's see here. Five. This is the last question. What is below the dome and above the dome and beyond the dome? Heaven, hell, more land. That was just what I was saying. Heaven, hell, more land. If indeed all these musicians and stars don't die but move on to hidden lands or worlds, then the secret is pretty well kept. No, I think musicians and stars do die. Do I think that heaven lies outside this thing? It's not exactly heaven what you would see as heaven. We're not talking about choirs of angels and harps and white robes and stuff like that. But it is an unlimited universe where you can do pretty much anything you want. And the only power that you have is your imagination, which is why I think, and I know people will say, oh, Einstein was a fraud. Yeah, he may have been a fraud in some ways, but he was probably one of the most quotable men in history. Very clever when it came to quotes. And one of his quotes was, imagination is more important than knowledge. Which you got to ask yourself, why would a lifelong physicist, an astrophysicist, make that quote? I mean, I know the greeting card quotes, you know, where he said, gravity, you know, cannot be responsible for people falling in love. That's a t-shirt, and I love that. But when he says imagination is more important than knowledge, it took me a long time to figure out what that was. And that's because in the unlimited universe, the only weapon you have against the word forever is imagination. That's it. It is a wish machine. You want to know what's outside here? It's a wish machine. It is a box that sits in front of you and says, what do you want? With a big question mark on it. And you can ask what you can ask it whatever you want. You can have it do whatever you want. And you're thinking, wow, that's the greatest thing ever. Yeah, it's the greatest thing ever until you run out of ideas. Then it's not the greatest thing ever. Then you've got to come up with something. Then you've got to shift your perspective and you've got to figure out something that makes you appreciate where you are or where you were. That's this place. That is. I quote Joe Walsh, I can't complain, but sometimes I still do. Life's been good to me so far. And that's from his song, where he was talking about the life of a rock star and how it's ideal and how everyone wants to be, you live the life of a rock star, you know, where you have celebrities and you have everything you want, right? Being the rock star. But he's saying that no matter what you have, you always complain. And that's true with this world. And not to get off on a rant here, but it is true. You know, no matter how rich, how powerful, how beautiful, how talented you are, I don't care if you're an athlete, if you're a rock star, if you're an actress, all these things don't make any difference because you will find something to complain about. You'll complain about the plumbing in your mansion. You'll complain about the service on your high-end sports car. You'll complain about your servants and your flight to the French Riviera and the boat you were on. You're gonna find something to complain about. You gotta ask yourself why. Why do we always complain about this? Why is bliss such short-lived? And that's because that's what this place was designed to be. You're not supposed to find pure happiness here and pure love and pure bliss on tap, to steal a line from The Devil's Advocate. You're not going to find that here. That's deliberate. So anyway, that's for this guy. That's your ending quote I'm going to give for this. And anyway, his name is Ed Lundegaard from Fargo, North Dakota. Okay. Let's see here. This is a short, very short email by comparison. This one is, who is to say the world won't implode on itself if said person can make an impact comes forward? And that's the question is, if Flat Earth comes out, if it actually comes out, will the world implode? It has the potential to, of course. If the powers that be want to turn it into something that launches World War III, they could probably do it. But they could also turn it into a golden age. If it's handled right, if you introduce, but it would take the creators or someone representing the creators to make an appearance, because without that guidance, yeah, then people end up doing the whole rats in a cage thing. We're in a cage. Oh my God. Everybody, you know, have billions of people say that we're in a cage and see what happens. It'd be bad. It would be really, really bad, unless you had whoever built this place, this wonderful structure, this Hollywood studio. If you had whoever it was make an appearance or make some announcement and saying, yeah, don't, you know, you're in a building, don't sweat it. Here's why, we'll be along shortly. And then you could turn it into something cool. Let's see here. Elliot writes, watched some of your film. That's the subject. Hello, I watched some of your documentary, Under the Dome? Obviously, I'm confused and suspending judgment on what I've been taught and what I'm hearing now. I really don't know what to ask, but wanted to reach out and see if you had anything you would like to say to someone who has woken up to a lot lies in the world, but unsure what to believe without getting solid proof of such things as the Flat Earth. Thank you for any reply, Elliot. Well, Elliot, hopefully you're listening to this. And if you're new to this, honestly, just keep digging in. And you probably have at this point. The rabbit hole goes very, very deep. And, you know, just type in Flat Earth into YouTube. That's probably the easiest way. And just start going down the list. It will take you down separate paths. Luckily, most people are on the same page. And by the time you get done not sleeping for 2 weeks, you will hopefully have some sort of awakening. There you go. Mike writes, how they fake weightlessness. I was wondering how high you would have to go to experience weightlessness, and I googled it. The answer was not a specific height. The answer came up on Quora, Q-U-O-R-A, and it said, imagine you were in a bus and it was dropped. You would be weightless inside the bus as you dropped. Not much of an answer. Could the answer to how they fake weightlessness in the ISS be that in some situations a bunch of containers that are welded together in the shape of the ISS are dropped from a height high enough to give the astronauts several minutes to fake us out before chutes open and the containers and crew safely land on the ground? Mike Horde from Atlanta. Mike, and don't laugh at Mike, because actually it's at least it's a clever question he came up with. What Mike does not know is that there are specially designed planes that can do exactly that right now. It's called parabolic flight, and you just take a jet airplane, you crank it up, you go really, really high, and then you dive, and as you dive you become weightless and you can simulate weightlessness. That's how supposedly they train astronauts on weightlessness. The funny thing is how they train them turns out to be exactly like what we see, you know, when they show the interior ISS shots. And I think they can do it from time to time, but they can't do it constantly, obviously, because you can't, you know, you have a limited amount of time by the time you start diving before you have to pick it up back up again. And, you know, then you start editing footage, but that's what they're doing. So no, they don't actually, but yeah, you could actually drop containers technically if you wanted to, but I don't think that'd be the best way to do it, because you're risking stuff, you know, and you're putting yourself at unnecessary risk, and plus it'd be logistically also tougher, because you'd have to get up to a plane to a certain height and then you'd have to drop it, and then yeah, it'd be a pain in the ass, but not a terrible idea. I like his workaround. Let's see. Chase writes, thank you for ruining my life in a good way. Mr. Sargent, I want to thank you for ruining my life. In 2015, I heard your interview on Canary Cry Radio. Then I listened to it about 10 more times. Your presentation of an alternative shape to the Earth seemed to connect with me immediately. Not so much as absolute truth, but as a great exercise in why I believe what I do. I have always attracted to breaking down ideas and seeing how they stand up. After looking at the work of others, I am at the point where I am at least convinced that the heliocentric model is the farthest from the truth. I also wanted to share with you some flat earth related experiences from my life. I will bullet point to the next part since, if you read this on air, you may have to stop for callers. Well, in this case, I don't have to stop for callers. When I was growing up in the 1990s, my paternal grandfather would often say to my brother and I that the earth was flat. I do not think that he believed in a flat earth, but did this to tease us a bit. We would reply with the standard answer of, everybody knows it is round. We would then reply that if we took a level out to the road, we never did, we would see that he was right. I can only imagine talking with him about this now, if he were still alive. Interesting. During the 1990s, a country song came out called Small Town Saturday Night by Hal Ketchum. The song has in it the following lyrics. Bobby told Lucy the world ain't round, drops off sharp at the edge of town. Lucy, you know the world must be flat, because when people leave town, they never come back. It's nice. I like that. 3. Cartoon Network's regular show had an episode in their 7th season that has the main cast trapped in a dome against their will. During their time in, many of them change their personalities for the better. The only one who reacts negatively is the boss character that wants to blow the lid off the conspiracy. Spoiler alert, at the end, they escape the dome by blowing up the simulated moon to create an opening. All of the weather is simulated in the dome. After the escape, two of the characters have some interesting lines. The boss character states that there could be more domes outside of that one. Another character exclaims that they had reached the final frontier, a phrase coined in reference to space. Knowing the alternative view of the Earth's shape made the episode extra enjoyable. They have at least two more dome-related episodes that I have not watched yet. In February 2010, I flew from Atlanta, Georgia to Tokyo, Japan for a military training exercise. The flight took about 15 hours. While in the air, I watched the map that showed our location while we were flying. According to the map, we went up to Alaska and stayed close to the coast and then went south to Japan. This only made sense because I heard that planes like to stay over land in case of emergencies. But on a whim, I looked at the AE map, and the flight is almost straight shot from just about anywhere in the US through Alaska to Japan. It was very interesting. It was a very interesting realization and has made me more convinced of a flatter shape to our world. 5. I swear that since hearing and studying various flat earth enclosed world theory, the sky, sun, moon, stars, clouds, etc. seem closer than they did before. Long before I heard of flat earth enclosed world theory, I would often say, I don't think the world is flat, but if it was, I wouldn't be surprised. I would say this usually when talking about government corruption and conspiracy theories. Once again, thank you. I catch your show primarily on YouTube and occasionally on Truth Frequency. I must confess that I regularly break the first two rules of Flat Club. I often add the idea that I compensated for the flat earth when I am asked how I did something. I also cannot help but dangle the subject out there to see where it leads. So far, I have found it true that the most who dismiss it do so without any consideration of evidence. I occasionally post flat earth material on social media, including a meme that I made. Thank you. David writes, hey Mark, last night I heard your interview with Chris Everard. Great job. You had an answer for nearly all of his questions. Here's my question. Within the last year, I read the Elon Musk bio, so I'm curious if you believe that his SpaceX company is totally in on it. Supposedly, his rockets are under contract with NASA to go to the space station. Thanks, David. No, I don't think SpaceX is completely in on it, but I think there's a few people at the high end of that are. And, you know, they're paying, I think the government's probably paying them at this point to blow up rockets because they're not going anywhere. The fact they just blew up a rocket, I think, what, 2 weeks ago? Not even 2 weeks ago? Elon Mayno, I don't see much happening there. Again, you know, every rocket that blows up on the pad delays any Mars program, which is why I think they're doing it. It's ridiculous. So no, I don't think they're in on it. There might be a few people at the top that know, but most like any company, 99% of the people that work there, they're just wrench turners. They don't know anything. Let's see here. Is this from Steve? I can't tell. Yeah, I think it's from Steve. Okay. Steve writes, hi, Mark. I am adding this to the first email I sent you nearly a year ago, so you know I have been following you a long time in the flat earth world anyway. I came across you and the topic fairly early on. There were only a few videos to watch back then. Now there are thousands. You helped me a ton to get this in my head. Eric DeBay, the Morgail, and Jaronism are the others I follow. I really enjoy you and your calm, measured, patient approach. You respect people being skeptical and give them all a chance. I do not pay attention to those who call names and slander others in the FE. I know you and I do not need anyone else's approval. I think the Morgail and Jaronism are similar in approach to you as far as everybody getting along and not bad-mouthing each other. That is good. Just an FYI, I stopped listening to anyone as soon as they drop the F-bomb, and if there is too much background music, I shut it down. Who needs music to listen to? I find it distracting and annoying. I love your videos. My one thought is on clue number 11, Hiding God. You appeal very nicely to those... Wait, was 11 Hiding God? I thought it was 10. Anyway. You appeal very nicely to those who are carrying this deception out and ask them to stop it and do what is right. My thought is this. The person and force behind this is Satan himself, the father of lies. Everything God is about, Satan is about destroying and doing the opposite of. I think the people involved in the deception are sold out to Satan for the most part. However, you may get one person who has unwittingly been dragged along who may be willing to out the facts. I guess that is your goal, and I think it is a great idea. I was just wondering if you also believe that Satan is the great deceiver and the one behind the great deception of the ball earth. Ooh, very possible. Very possible. I can't confirm it, of course, but yeah, that's a good one. I'm not gonna shoot that down. Much talk is out there about the Vatican and the new Pope ushering in the alien deception, that the aliens created us and are back here to help us, etc. That would require maintaining the globe deception, I think. Admitting God would blow up their scheme. I also have another quote I love. It is from Richard Feynman, and I do not think he is a believer in God. He says, I would rather have questions that can't be answered than answers that can't be questioned. Oh, that's good. You may already know that one, but if not, I think you will like it. Yes, I do. God bless you and keep up the great work, Mark. P.S. So far, I've convinced about 20% of my family. It takes a while, and they have to think about it a lot. Then think they've figured it out for themselves. Ha, but that's fine with me. Yeah, just put the seeds in people's head and don't worry about convincing them. Just get them to look at it. Let's see, this one's from Joyce. YouTube viewer. Hi, Mark. I just completed watching your YouTube documentary, They Are Hiding God. No doubt a tremendous amount of time, research, and development. Very well done. Mark, I have to admit that after 2 hours of watching, it still was not clear how the shape of the earth could be the huge deception that you say it is, that the Creator is real and watching. I've come to understand and believe that the great flood of Noah was a cataclysmic event that altered the atmosphere surrounding the earth, the ecosystem, and the plates themselves. Does the flat earth theory have a connection to this event? Yes, I think that the flood, and I think there were previous versions of this, you know, this civilization. And the one with Noah in it was just one of the earlier ones. I mean, if we're 6.0 or 7.0, you know, talk about Noah being 2.0 or 3.0. So I think there was a connection, absolutely. It still happened. It just happened inside an enclosed system. Anyway, sorry. I didn't doubt your information regarding Antarctica, GPS, astronaut interviews, and the moon landing interviews. I just don't see how the shape could affect my faith or lack thereof in the Creator. I picked up on your reference to the biblical event in the Tower of Babel. My faith in the one true Creator God has never before been attached to the shape of the earth. I only vaguely remember that discussion in science and history in school about the earth being flat and the fear of going to the edge and falling off and something about the Catholic Church. I am open to receiving new and or clarifying information. I await your reply. Warm regards, Joyce. And yeah. Look, if you believe in the Creator either way, and the shape of the earth doesn't make any difference to you, wonderful. Good for you. You're going to have an easy, easy time adjusting to this. However, there's going to be a whole bunch of people, and by that I mean 90% of the people out there in the world, that are going to have a hard time adjusting to this. And they're going to be looking for guidance. Maybe you can kind of help them along. That's my recommendation to you, Joyce. Just think about all your neighbors. If all of a sudden they realize that there was evidence of God out there, what's going to happen to them? Steve writes, Flat Earth Addict. Hi, Mark. Thanks for all your work. From watching the Flat Earth Clues a few months ago, you got me hooked. Since then, I've been literally obsessed with the Flat Earth. Also, what blew my mind was the lack of relevant response from the scientific community. I think the game is up and they know it. If I can make an observation, I think that with the current evidence out there and the ability that anyone can easily disprove the globe, it seems that the only thing preventing the truth from being demanded is publicity. Best regards, Steve Peterson, South Africa. Thanks, Steve. Honestly, that's great. Well, let's see here. The subject line is, 'Twas an unexpected treat. Good morning. Oh, I think it's a poem. It's a poem. Gotta read a poem. Good morning, my good sir. I really must concur. The mind aflame and above the game. I have a question, as it were. 2 points are what I'll make, and in short order it will take. It's fast and it's quick, and there is no trick, and clearly no mistake. The question that I ask will be bringing you to task. Upon your brain will be great strain, and in my glory I will bask. It's like I'm getting a message from the Riddler. Seriously. And now here comes question one, though I trust you're having fun. Upon your noggin, a mental floggin, beneath a glowing sun. The question poses why they perpetrate the lie. Perhaps they fear that their end is near and cannot bear to die. This force that has deceived, and over nonsense we have grieved. Do you feel the truth will appeal to all mindless that believed? That may have taken long, but it was a cheerful song. It was a song, is it? Another time without the rhyme from the wastelands of Hong Kong. Yeah, I think the truth will appeal to everybody. I do. I think if it's handled right, I think you can turn this into the next golden age. I really, really believe that. And I'm not just being an optimist here. I really think it's possible. So let's make that happen, shall we? Oh, sorry. There's more. Well done, but more to come, no doubt. Oh, it's not the rest. Perhaps a word when you are free. Kindest regards from Mr. E. P.S. The poem works best with Popeye's tune. Wow. So, yeah, somebody do that. Take Popeye's tune and read those lyrics. Followed by Rob, who also has a poem. Fantastic. Work in progress. Is it flat or is it round? Let us judge upon the ground, not by images taken from space that are obviously cut and paste. If in reply you swear and cuss and can't logically discuss, feel free to bury your head in the ground because it's obviously flat and not round. That's from Rob G. Thanks, Rob. Subject, movie, Under the Dome. Dear sir, recently saw your documentary movie, Under the Dome. Excellent evidence presented. However, when you get to number 11, any logic, if one values free will, fails. The presumption that the truth, once revealed, would make the earth a better place is dubious. It wasn't very good in ancient times when human religions already had the truth, flat earth, as you mentioned early on. But more importantly, the idea that more direct knowledge of creators will encourage us to be more civilized, or else, is in no way allows the individual to make the right choices without the threat of punishment, thereby subverting the human growth potential to the level of compelled behavior, something an informed creator would easily see through, unless the creator wants strict militaristic obedience, like the world we already live in. Any feedback appreciated? Respectfully, Lee Paddy, PhD. Can it be any worse than it is now? You know, if I'm of course, you know, people are looking over their shoulder, you know, they should be doing the right thing. I'm saying that the creator is probably going to step in and give us some guidance, because without guidance, we are a mess and we need help. You know this as well as anybody. Really, you want to keep things going the way they are, because we're just augering this world into the ground. No play on words there. We're destroying this place. So the creator's coming in, the teacher coming in, the guidance counselor coming in and giving us a little help, I think would be very much appreciated at this point. Richard writes, I am convinced in the flat earth model. My only question is, where is Nibiru, otherwise known as Planet X, if it exists, and or the biblical wormwood in the flat earth model? In the glass dome, firmament, or outside it, Richard. Planet X, anything you see in the sky is going to be part of the system. Do I think there's a giant planet out there that's going to come in and wipe this place out? No, not anymore. And I used to be a big believer in Planet X. I think the Wormwood star is just a star. I think it's part of the system that's going to be thrown to the ground. Kind of like in the biblical, I can't remember the passage, where it says the stars are going to fall to the ground like figs from a tree, shaken from a tree. I think Wormwood's just another version of that. Planet X, don't buy it. Whatever you see. If somebody says Planet X is in the sky, I don't care what it does. I don't care the weather changes. I don't care what you think it is or what they portray it is. If the mainstream media starts talking about Planet X, don't believe it. It is just in the sky, and it is just part of the system. It is not something that's going to be, you know, our eventual doom. Sorry, that's from Richard. We can do a few more. I think we can actually knock this out if we go fast enough. High school talk. Hello, I've been with you for about a year, still learning and spreading the truth, proving the lie. The reason for my email is that I have two sons, 17 and 14, still a little resistant, but coming around. The whole God thing bothers them. I believe they are hiding the real one. Back to my point, or what I wanted to tell you. I went to see my son play football in Tennessee. I'm from South Carolina. I went to their pregame meal, and the first thing out of one of my son's friend's mouth was, "Tell him the world is flat." So the movement is moving into the high schools. I fly over to Tennessee to see his games, and things are a lot different since there's no forest on flat earth. You can see the stumps. Nice. Thank you. Wesley writes, "Hello, my name is Wesley Simpson, and I am very curious about this flat earth theory. I've watched your video, Under the Dome, and I find it very fascinating, and I'm doing a lot of my own research about this, and it seems to be a lot bigger than we think, and it needs to be known we have been lied to for too long. If you have any further discoveries, please let me know." Excellent. This one's called No Forest on Flat Earth. I just watched the video with the title above. You can reply or not, and that's fine. Please consider what I have to say. Accept these things as fact for a moment. These huge trees have been cut down. What were they used to build? Consider the Tower of Babel. They built the tower so they could reach God. We know that the dome is 73 miles up. I don't know about that. How much stone would it take to build a tower that high? I'm not an engineer, but it would have to have a very wide base, about the size of Greenland, and would need huge blocks to construct. couldn't those trees have been used to build the Tower of Babel? Consider for a moment that the flood covered everything, including those trees. Maybe the salt water acted as a catalyst to speed up the hardening process of the trees. There are several generations of Noah mentioned before this takes place. It took some time to get mankind back to where there were enough of them to build such a thing. They had to have amazing technology still left from before the flood. Maybe the Nephilim helped them. Who knows? I just had this thought, and thought I would pass it on to someone who has better resources than I do to follow this line of thought. You should say thought a few more times. Thank you for reading this. Sincerely, Thomas. It's very interesting, Thomas, and I'm going to pass this on to people. No question. Let's see here. Dear Mark, my name is Emmanuel. I am writing you from London in the UK. I've just watched your documentary, Under the Dome. I must thank you for all the great information in it. I've only started a couple days ago researching about this flat earth topic after a friend of mine told me he believes in it. I must say that it is pretty shocking to have my mind blown up by the truth behind the greatest cover-up in human history. I am a new born-again Christian, but still never paid enough attention to the scriptures related to formation of the earth. In fact, is true the Bible never describes a rotating sphere around the sun, just another planet in the Milky Galaxy. Actually, the Bible truly describes a flat earth inside a dome, firmament to divide the waters above and below. This is the truth. Yet we tried so hard to adapt and interpret the biblical truth according to human knowledge. I must confess, I've never taken seriously the idea to doubt the very shape of the earth and the reality of the universe. I've been watching various videos and read different websites, including Rob Skiba, Dave Murphy, but according to what is truly going on in Antarctica, I've been following also the theory supported by Steve Quayle, which our Nazis are actually living in entire underground cities under the snow, basically ruling the world with an extra-dimensional race of fallen angelic beings and the hybrids created by them. I have no problems in believing these theories, not only because I am the first conspiracy theorist, but first of all because I believe that we're living in times like the days of Noah described in Genesis, Nephilim and hybrid creatures devoted to the destruction of humanity. I am writing you to ask you, what is your personal take on Antarctica? You already know it. I've already done videos on it. Do you personally believe the Nazis are there ruling with the ETs? No, I don't. If the Nazis there, I don't think there's any Nazis left down there. I think at the most, they probably asked them for exile and they are gone. I don't think there are any Nazis left down there. Or do you simply believe the elite found something to keep secret, like the edge of the earth? Yes, I do. Could it be both? No, I don't. Perhaps this is the reason the Nazis chose Antarctica. No, I think they chose it because they had one of the old maps and just went down there during World War II. Remember, the Nazis were the only people to be down in Antarctica during World War II. Everybody else was doing the war, but they were doing multiple things, trying to get an edge anywhere they could. What would happen if even commercial airlines could fly freely above it? Well, you don't want that to happen. What would we be able to see there? Well, I think eventually you'd find the edge, like Admiral Byrd did. The world we are living in is a never-ending lesson, and I strongly believe that as it is written in the last days, the knowledge will increase. Not by chance, the flat earth discussion is back in public after centuries of silence. Why now? I believe these are the last days for sure. Truly and deeply appreciated your material. Thanks again. May God keep you safe in this ministry of awakening people. You know what? Let's end this one with that. And we'll pick it up next time. So, thanks guys.
Baby, what is this? What is this? Is that a model of the flat geocentric earth? Nice.